stream live and on-demand TV.
If you haven't heard about HelloFresh,
May I have the immediate family meet us in the prayer room up here, please? The immediate family, we're going to have a time of prayer.
Joe, family, my deepest sympathies. I'm very, very sorry for your loss. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, your word tells us that when the righteous cry out, you hear them, and you deliver them from all of their troubles. It goes on to say that you are close to the brokenhearted and that you save those who are crushed in spirit. So we cry out to you, Father, in this hour, trusting that you hear us and that you will deliver us. I ask that you would be very close to those whose hearts are broken today, and that you would indeed save those whose spirits are crushed. Father, please envelop Jo and her family with your peace and with your comfort. May they sense your presence in a profound and very, very precious way this morning, as well as in the days and in the weeks and in the months to follow. May they know your very deep love for them, and may they experience afresh your very sufficient grace for their lives. Father, as we remember Jim's life and legacy this morning, may we honor his memory, and even more, as I know Jim would want it, may we bring glory to your holy name. Jim loved you and he served you while here on this earth, and he loves you and he serves you even more now as he basks in your very presence. I know that he would want above all things that your name be exalted and lifted high. May we be faithful to that end. Holy Spirit, settle on us. Comfort us. Guide us. And strengthen us. May our time together this morning be rich. May it glorify you. May it honor Jim's memory. And may it bring healing and refreshing and renewal to all who loved Jim and who grieve his passing. Father, we lean on you. I ask you to be very close to us. I pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This time I'd like to ask Eric Benson if he'd come and share a eulogy with us.
I'll try to look at all of you, but a lot of places to look. My name is Eric Benson. I'm the oldest son-in-law. I'm married to Emily. The first time I met Jim was just a few weeks after I met Emily. She was staying in the bottom part of a house that I lived in for a few weeks before she went to Germany as a study abroad student. She asked to go home to Topeka, and I took her late at night. Jim was the one who opened the door, kind of scantily clad, and he grunted in acknowledgement. I wasn't sure whether I was actually going to stay for the night, but I didn't really have a choice. He motioned me in, pointed to a sofa with a couple of words, and I was in. The next morning, I was awoken a little too early by a voice. Is he awake? I realized that whoever was speaking to me was about 2 inches away, so I left my eyes closed until he moved away. And at that point, I met Charlie, who was about 7 years old. From that point forward, I was welcome. I was invited to the breakfast table. Everybody asked who I was. And I never really doubted whether it was a place that I could call home. In the half of my life that I've known Jim and Joe, I have never witnessed a house that has been so open to strangers who are no longer strangers when they walk through the front door. As life progressed, Emily and I dated. We eventually got married. But I'm a little ahead of myself. Before that, my parents met Jim and Joe. It was a great evening, but the next day was pretty hard. Emily was in a pretty serious accident. I got the phone call. I went to the hospital and checked to see that she was okay, and I called Jim and Joe. They arrived about an hour later, and Jim checked to see if she was okay, and he did something that I will never forget. I did not grow up in church. I was not a faithful man. What I had heard before when you say, I will pray for you, it was a lot like somebody saying, we should go to lunch sometime. Jim's first action was to gather everybody around and pray to God that Emily would be healed and to pray for the peace of all of us there. For those of you who don't believe in God, that's okay. He was a principled man. The actions that he did were reflected in the words that he said. I never really doubted where his heart was. Jim also officiated our wedding. That was pretty cool. I knew he was nervous when he called me Erica, but it was okay. It makes me smile to this day. Over time, Jim taught me how to do a lot of things. He taught me how to fish. He taught me how to cast a line so I didn't catch myself in the neck. He taught me how to use an auger, ice fishing. Taught me how to fillet and grill the fish that I caught every once in a while. He also taught me how to hit a ball with a bat, along with my kids. And if he could teach me to bat, he can teach anybody to bat. He was a good coach, like Charlie. We were pretty different, but there was one thing that we did have in common, and that was being working professionals. At one point, Jim invited me to go on a trip with him to different rural hospitals. And on the way, we talked a little bit about who we would meet, who, you know, where we would go, what he was looking for. And he would ask just a couple of questions when he was there. Usually, hey, how are you? How's it going? What's this? What's that? But the magic for me happened after we left. He started to talk about the things that he learned in between all the questions. It was like Sherlock Holmes for business. He was always putting the pieces together and figuring out what was underneath the hood to figure out how he could improve it and make things better. Over the years, he and I talked a number of occasions as I increased in my managerial responsibilities about problems I was running into. And he would usually stop me before I was done talking, because I'm a talker, and tell me what I needed to hear. And I use those lessons to this day. I live in a town called Wamego. It's about 10 and a half hours south of here. 12 and a half if you've got kids, 9 if you're Jim. And when everybody would arrive, usually it was Jim and Joe and Dominic and Charlie, and they'd get out of the car, he would unload everything, and he would grab a couple of my kids to go to the local grocery store where he would get spare ribs or fried chicken because it was a small town grocery store. And he'd let the kids pick up whatever they wanted to. So inevitably, they came back with the standard stuff, right? Cookies or ice cream, donuts, the occasional head of cauliflower, bananas. Whatever they wanted was what came home. And he'd sit down for about 10 minutes, and he'd start to fidget. And at that point in time, we knew it was time for the house project. So Emily and I would talk. Usually she would ask me if it was okay, which project to work on. And our house is full of small improvements that he made in every room. It was also the place where I saw him the happiest. So for a brief moment, for those of you who know him pretty well, close your eyes and think of Jim in a good mood. My good mood for him is him holding a punk ready to light a firework. Wamego is home to one of the 10 best firework shows in the country, according to Wamego and a couple of blogs. We have volunteers who shoot 55,000 shells over 45 minutes. The shells are set up in a quad of baseball diamonds. Everybody sits on the soccer fields that are right next door. And that entire thing happens in my backyard. Those baseball diamonds are there. There's a creek, my backyard, my house. The first time Jim experienced that, he said he would be back every year. It's like Christmas in July. When he would show up, we would go to the different fireworks stores or fireworks stands, and he would do things like bribe the choir. He'd say, I will give you an extra $50 if you sing me a song right now. He would talk to the football players and ask what positions they played and how they liked football. He would talk to the church youth groups and say ask them what they were fundraising for. And the whole time, he was trying to figure out what the best prices were. We oftentimes went to three and went back to another one just to make sure that we got the right stuff. His favorite firework was a little thing that looked like a big firecracker that burned in a little pyramid, made a lot of noise for about 3 minutes. It burned itself completely out, cost a dollar. That was his favorite because it was the biggest bang for the buck. If you can imagine, there's 40,000 people that descend on this town of 4,800. All the streets are full of cars and everything like that. Jim would hold court at the end of our driveway out in the street just a little ways. And when he lit the fireworks, the people would stop and he would wave like he was the master of ceremonies for the Benson family fireworks show. And when the firework was lit, he would start to walk back with a smile, getting ready for the next one. He helped Dominic not lose fingers. I told you Charlie talked to me the first time from about 2 inches away, and that's how he lights a firework. He bends over and puts his face right up next to the punk so he can see it. Yep. Jim is alive to this day Charlie is alive to this day thanks to Jim's efforts. At 10 o'clock, we'd go to the fireworks show, watch all the fireworks and everything like that, but the whole time, he had a big smile on his face. There was a little cooler by the door with Diet Coke and Fresca, snacks to eat, kind of an unofficial family reunion. Those are the kinds of things that are going to change. Family rituals will change. Who mows the yard will change. How many shows you're watching at the TV at once will change. And someone has to pick up the call to bring the real Fresca back in cans. We'll come up with different ways of making these things happen. And I know that Jim would want us to get them done with the resources that we have and develop new memories for ourselves. For me, the lessons I've learned, and I imagine you've learned from watching this good man, will stay with us until the end of our days. I, for one, will miss him greatly.
I got the privilege of doing music with Jim. It's a lot of fun. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on his portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. You who are weak. is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies, mercies for you and for me? Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Time is now fleeting, the moments are passing, passing from you and from me. Shadows are gathering, deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for the wonderful love he has promised, promised for you and for me. Though we have sinned, he has mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Calling, oh sinner, come
home. Now we'll have some scripture readings. First, I would like to invite Lydia Wade to come up. She's going to read Psalm 139, 1 through 18. And for each of the scripture readers, if I could remind you to hold the microphone right up to your chin so we can hear you well. So come on in.
Feels weird. Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know me when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even in the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. If you created, for you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them became to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you.
Josephine Benson will be reading John 14, 1 through 6.
A reading from John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
And now Philip Gwost will be reading Luke 13, 22 through 30.
The Gospel according to Luke. Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Someone asked him, Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? He said to them, make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, sir, open the door for us. But he will answer, I don't know you or where you came from. Then you will say, we ate and drank with you, and you taught in our streets. But he will reply, I don't know you or where you came from. Away with me, all you evildoers. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from the east and the west and the north and the south, and will take their places at the feet in the kingdom of God. Indeed, there are those who are last, who will be first, and first who will be last.
Now Margaret Benson will be reading John 15, 1 through 8.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, he can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. This is to my Father's glory that you will bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples.
Chrissy Haggerty is now going to share with us.
Hi, my name is Chrissy Haggerty, and I am Jim's sister. Jim, a brother, a dad, a grandpa, a husband, friend, nurse, teacher, student, a counselor. He had so many roles to so many people. In these many roles, he carried a common thread of strong values and joy in life. Jim knew who he was and what he believed. He would share these beliefs with other people when asked, and still had an open heart and mind to listen to others' beliefs without judging. Because of this, I think that he was a safe place when you needed to talk, question, or even just ponder about something. There are so many memories of Jim, his love of Joe and family, of flowers and nature, his love of knowledge, and of course, his love of sports. I was honored to be able to live with Jim and Joe for 6 weeks a long time ago while we were building a house. They welcomed my young family into their home with open arms. You really get to know someone when you spend 24/7 with them. What a great gift to me. Because they lived in Kansas for so many years, and he was in the first batch of us 11 kids, so I didn't know him much at all. Well, this experience let me learn about the true Jim and Joe. When we lived with them, before every meal, after prayer, he would lean over to give Joe a kiss. I remembered thinking, should Dan and I be doing this too? It was a sweet sight. Even on our cruise that we took with them 2 years ago, they still would lean over for a kiss before eating each meal. I also remember the sense of strong family values at these meals. As they were always prepared, they were a balanced, delicious meal waiting for us after work. Thank you, Joe. Plus, my kids liked the idea that you served dessert every single night. And Charlie, too. We would all talk about our day and how it went, one person at a time, according to Joe's rules. Every person at the table was acknowledged. Jim and Joe had a way of making you feel important, valued, and listened to, no matter who you were or what you had to say. After the meal each night, it was time to do homework. I could hear Jim teaching and advising Chelsea on her chemistry and math for hours, almost nightly, at their kitchen counter. I remembered thinking that she was so lucky to have him as a tutor, and that he must have done that with the rest of the kids, too. No wonder why they all turned out so smart, confident, and having great careers. He was very proud of you guys. He had a knack of being a scholar and then sharing that knowledge with others. He even took higher level college courses at St. Cloud State after retiring. Who does that? He loved learning about the body and how it functioned. He told me that cells were his favorite. He even told me that sometimes he would have to correct his prof after class if he or she didn't explain something the right way. Now, being a teacher myself, I just cringed thinking, oh, that poor prof. But I knew his intent was to aid in the best teaching possible for all those young, spongy science brains in that classroom. Not only did Jim teach his family, but he taught me too. Not only about academics, but about staying true to what is right and wrong, and strong in what you believe. At first, his advice and counsel was a big brotherly type, and then it turned into a fatherly type the past few years. He would always check back with me to see how things were going. I actually remember looking at his hands a couple months ago when he was visiting my house and thinking, geez, those look like my dad's exactly. I told him that too, and he just chuckled. I cherish and honor that Jim took on that role because I lost my dad at a young age of 17. Side note, I remember when he asked to hold Jack, my grandson, my first grandson, when he was about 4 months old. Joe and him were sitting out on their back deck watching the sunset like they usually did in the afternoon. And I was thinking, ooh, I don't know if that's a good idea because Jack is pretty fussy for me. But the second that Jim took him, Jack calmed down. Jim then continued holding him for the next 30 minutes. Every 5 to 10 minutes, I would say, do you want me to take Jack back in case he did? And he said, nope, I want to hold him. So during that whole time, I didn't hear a peep out of Jack. I know Jack just felt the calmness and strength of Jim. I remember thinking, geez, I wish Dad was alive to hold him, but this is pretty dang close. Flowers were another passion of his. Thank you, Doris. He would often comment on mine when he would drive his old 1956 bicycle over to our house during the summer just to say hi or hey, what's up. I lived about less than a mile from him, and I love that. Last summer, he asked me to go on a bike ride one nice summer day, so I did. Well, we got about 2 miles out, and we heard a big pop, which scared both of us. We started laughing when we figured out it was his old back tire. We had to call my husband Dan to come and get us. I told him that he should buy a new bike since his bike was old. He answered, why? This one works just fine. I will just get a new tire. He was like my mom in that sense. He loved using old things. As for the love of flowers, he knew any name of any flower that I would ask about. He would tell me at the end of each summer not to throw away my plants, as he could house them over the winter and bring them back to life the next spring. He was proud of that. His latest experiment was my accent plant, the King Tut. He loved that one and did a great job bringing it back to life. Currently, my latest King Tut is in my garage because I haven't thrown it out yet, frozen. And all past fall, when he would come to see me, he would mention that he was curious if I could still get it to come back. So I'm going to try and see what happens when spring comes. He was always very generous sharing his talents, be it teaching how to put up tiles for a backsplash, building our platform from our stairs in the garage, or clearing trees from our latest yard project. He would bring Dominic and Charlie with and direct them what to do. He loved seeing them interact with family and help out when they could. We would usually celebrate after by going to Shooters for a burger basket and a root beer. His other passion was sports. He played many sports in high school. My husband Dan remembers many times when he would come over to our house for the Vikings football games. The first thing he would yell when coming in the door was not, "Go Vikings," it was, "K-State won." He loved K-State. He would always say college football was so much better than professional. Jim showed up at almost all of our Vikings games that we would host. And he would show up with a can of mixed nuts and a half a bag of red Twizzlers almost every time. And sometimes, if we were lucky, he would bring baby salted nut rolls. He would sit in the same chair in my dining room, kind of in back of everyone, never on the couch up front, for a reason, I thought. I think the reason being is he loved seeing Dominic and Charlie, who would sit on the couch with the cousins, interact with the cousins by yelling and cheering during those games. What a dedicated father to pick those two up every weekend and to spend time with them in some kind of an activity. They were his partners in crime. Dominic would inform me often that Jim was his dad, like I didn't know. And he would say it with pride. The last time that I saw Jim alive was on January 3rd for a Vikings game. After the game, my husband Dan invited Jim and my brother Al to come downstairs for a few minutes to watch some old videos that we had found. And these videos were of Jim and Al at my home growing up in Little Falls, visiting at my mom's. Well, of course, those minutes of watching turned into hours. We laughed, commented, and enjoyed these videos. In hindsight now, it was a great reflection of how Jim raised his then young kids and how he interacted with them. I remembered thinking, I wonder if Jim and Alan were analyzing and reflecting about their life and what amazing dads they were and how all of those sacrifices they made back then paid off to make the great adult kids they have now. Jim, you did a great job on earth. I want you now to go to heaven and enjoy and be with God. And please say hi to everyone from us.
Joe, would you like to come up?
Well, here we are. It's come to this. We've heard some wonderful things about this man. He loved to fix broken things. All my life, I saw him take 49-cent toys and spend 2 days trying to fix them. Sometimes he succeeded, sometimes he did not. All my life, I would drive with him in the car. And he'd say, "We should have done it this way. They should have done it that way. If they had only done it this way, it would have been better. Every time. It was just the nature of who he was. He wanted things to run smoothly. In his career, he did that with the doctors. At home, he did that with us. And always he did that with me. And I didn't always like it. And he got to know. But I don't think we ever argued. We sometimes had some pretty heated discussions. And I think sometimes the kids were a little bit nervous about that. But we always came out on top. And we're so dedicated to making it work. And I think the only people that lose in this game of life are the ones that quit. So we're not quitting. Jim was humble enough to know when he was wrong, which I found very interesting because his personality was so strong. But he was a humble man. Neither of us really got the message that there's one way to heaven early on. We grew into our relationship with the Lord. We both knew God when we met. We both loved him. We both knew Jesus. We both had a good background in knowing and loving the Lord. But he gently led us on. We believe that anybody who was good, believed in a God, it didn't matter what kind of relationship you had with, or how that relationship worked, as long as you believed in a God, you're fine. But you know, we both also like the truth. Not everybody can have the same truth if it looks different, if it's all a different color. Not everybody then has truth. And we both came to realize that scripture that says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And I can remember kind of choking that down and saying, huh? But something was broken in my thinking. And it needed to be fixed. And so I plunged ahead saying, I think I've been wrong. And coming to him saying, there's something wrong with the way I've been thinking all this time. And you know, he had to mull that over. He did not admit he was wrong yet. He had to mull that over. It took some time, but the Father so gently led us. This God is amazing, amazing God. He came so gently to us and nudged and nudged and nudged until we were hook, line, and sinker doing it God's way. God knew us from the very beginning, knew what we would be needing, knew how we would be needing to hear that. He knew neither of us could be fed in any way but gently. And he provided that. He stood back and made everyone else stand back until we made our own decisions. But then it was, do you know Jesus? Are you living it? That was the question I heard. He would come to complete strangers and say that. It's pretty cool to watch. I was more like, ah, you know Jesus, I can see it in your eyes. Can I pray for you? That was my speed. His was, hey, is your daughter walking with the Lord? Folks, if it's broke, fix it. There's a really good place that you will go to when you die if you fix it now. Don't be one of those who stands at the door and knocks, and Jesus will say, I never knew you. You didn't come the right way. I can't give you to my father because you didn't go through my shed blood, the blood that I loved so much and spilled out for you. Do it the right way. Fix it today. Because when you die, you will meet God. And I want him to be able to say to you, you guys whom I love so much, well done, good and faithful servant. Come, enter into the joy of my Father. Thank you for loving us. I love you back.
Thanks, Joe. The timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no tears, never crying again. Praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See all around. Now the nations will bow to sing. The only sound is the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the book are read. Well, I know the King, and there's no need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to the great I am. A mansion prepared for me, where I can live with my Savior eternally. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb.
Thank you, Aaron. COVID has ravaged our country and our world. It is an intruder that kills, reminding us that this world is seriously broken and is not our home. The Bible says that we are sojourners, just passing through. Today we celebrate the life of Jim Gwost and we rejoice with him that he has crossed the finish line. We also mourn his loss because we love him and miss him. Our passage in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18 can help us process this loss. Let me read it. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, concerning those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve like the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again in the same way through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For we say this to you by a word from the Lord. We who are still alive at the Lord's coming will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the archangel's voice, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are still alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. This passage comforts us and helps us know what happened to Jim. In verse 13, we see that those who have no hope fear death. He even tells us, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, concerning those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve like the rest who have no hope. There are many who die without hope. I have a list of famous quotes. I think I'll pass on it today, but famous quotes from atheists and the turmoil and tragedy of what they went through just before their death. They did not have this hope that Jim has. They have no hope because everyone in the world deep down knows there is something wrong with the world, and they know they are guilty of contributing to that wrong. When you come to know Jesus, you're set free from the guilt, washed completely clean. Jim died with hope. He knew Jesus. He was an amazing man. You can never quite tell if he was telling a joke or not. Jim was saved by grace, and it made a difference in his life. He was a true servant. When I say Jim died with hope, I don't mean that all that matters is sincerity. Joe brought this out very clearly. Proverbs 14:12 says, there is a way that seems right unto a man, but in the end it leads to death. No, it has to be based on truth. The true fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins and rose again from the dead. This brings us to our next verse. In verse 14, we see our hope is in the fact that Jesus died and rose again. It says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again in the same way through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. And there is tremendous evidence for the fact that Jesus rose again 3 days later after he died. The eyewitness testimony, the even non-Christian historical witness, it is simply amazing, and if you would like to find out more about that, I'd encourage you to ask me to go out for coffee with you. I'd love to tell you about it, because Jesus rose from the dead, and that makes all the difference in the world. In verses 15 through 17, we see that our hope is in the fact that Jesus is coming back. Let me read those again. For we say this to you by a word from the Lord, we who are still alive at the Lord's coming will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. And he's using the word fallen asleep to mean died. Okay. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the archangel's voice, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are still alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Do you know what this day is going to be like? The cumulus nimbus cloud with lightning flashing in it. Then a beam of sunlight pierces through to the ground below. And all of a sudden, Jesus bursts through the cloud, announced with a loud shout and trumpet blaring, "Prepare the way for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Those who are Christians who've already died will be coming back with him, and their bodies will erupt through the graves to join their souls. We will have physical bodies, though perfected for eternity. The kind of bodies that don't wear out anymore. I'm really looking forward to that one. The older we get, the more real this becomes. And we who are still alive at his coming, if we know the Lord, will fly up with them. Beam me up, Scotty. That's what we're going to see. We will meet Jim and Jesus up in the air. It will be incredible. And Jim will be there. And you can be too. The thing that is hindering you is sin and unbelief. God calls everyone to repent and believe, to admit that you're guilty and in need of a Savior, to recognize that the path you have been following is leading to destruction and you now want to follow God's path, to believe God loves you so much that he sent his Son to die on your behalf. He died to pay the penalty for your sins that you couldn't pay. To believe he rose from the dead and is coming back, and you want him in your life now. Do you want to follow him? God calls us to outwardly express that repentance and faith in baptism. Our trust in Christ and what he did for us is what saves us and gives us this hope. And verse 18 finishes, and it says, therefore, encourage one another with these words. This world is not our home. And we all know this deep down. C.S. Lewis said, if I find in myself desires which nothing in this world can satisfy, the only logical explanation is that I was made for another world. We were made for another world. Are you ready to meet him? Either in death or in the air, to be with Jesus and Jim forever. This is not a decision you make lightly. And as I said before, if you're interested, if you want to make sure of your eternity, let's get together. I'm available. You probably have a lot of questions. And I would love to get together for coffee and talk through those questions. There's no more important question than the question of eternity. Jim is happy right now. He's with Jesus. As we mourn for his loss, we celebrate his life, and we rejoice that he is with Jesus. We're going to finish with a song, and I've been asked to read a little bit of explanation for this song, okay? In the few days leading up to Jim's death, the chorus of the song you're about to hear woke Joe up several mornings. Although the first time it came to her, it was strong and clear, it became progressively quieter and slower until Friday, the day he died. It was just a faint whisper. It was apparent that the end had come, and also that the message of the song was a clear resonant message for Joe and the children, the grandchildren, and future generations. The message is no less for you who are here, those listening, and all those Jim and Joe have loved. Together they leave you with the rich words from this song, The Blessing, by Kari Job. Let's listen to the song. And now the family is going to be going out to the grave site, and please carpool if you can, but the rest of you will be dismissed after they leave. Thank you.
Children, their children, their children.